In recent years, there's been a trend toward more people doing so-called cold exposure. In part, this was popularized by Wim Hof, the so-called Iceman, getting into cold showers, taking ice baths, exposing oneself to cold water of various kinds, can in fact increase our levels of dopamine as well as the neuromodulator norepinephrine. This is not a new phenomenon. In the 1920s, a guy by the name of Vincent Prisnitz was one of the first people to popularize and formalize cold water therapies. He was an advocate of cold water exposure in order to boost the immune system and increase feelings of well-being. And actually, this practice dates back long before Vincent's popularized it. And Wim Hof is the more recent iteration of this. First of all, some of the safety parameters. Let's establish those first. Getting into very, very cold water, you know, 30 degree Fahrenheit or even low 40 degree Fahrenheit can put somebody into a state of cold water shock. I mean, people can die doing that. So obviously you want to approach this with some caution. But for most people, getting into 60 degree water or 50 degree water, or if you're acclimated and comfortable with it, 40 degree water or 45 degree water can have tremendously beneficial results on your neuromodulator systems, including dopamine. What temperature of water you can tolerate will depend on how cold water adapted you are and how familiar you are with the experience of getting into cold water. And when I say comfortable with, I should mention there is never a case in which getting into cold water does not evoke a release of epinephrine. So the quickening of the breath, the widening of the eyes, the feeling as if you can't catch your breath, and even some physical pain at the level of the skin, that happens almost every time or every time that you get into cold water, even if you're cold water adapted. What almost everybody knows and understands is that that wall, as I like to refer to it, is coming. That's always the first experience of getting into cold water. There's no real way around that. Now, this study that I mentioned earlier, Human Physiological Responses to Immersion into Water of Different Temperatures, really interesting study that was done and published in the the European Journal of Applied Physiology. I can provide a link to that study in the show caption. It's a really interesting study. They looked at people getting exposed to water that was warm, moderately cold, or very cold. It was 32 degrees Celsius, 20 degrees Celsius, or 14 degrees Celsius. You can just put those online and do the conversion, or you can do the conversion to Fahrenheit if you like. But in any case, what they looked at were the concentrations of things like epinephrine and dopamine and so on. And what they found was really interesting. First of all, upon getting into cold water, the changes in adrenaline and noradrenaline, epinephrine and norepinephrine, were immediate and fast, and these were huge increases. So that's the getting into the cold water that everybody experiences, these huge increases in adrenaline. But then what was interesting is they observed that dopamine levels started to rise somewhat slowly and then continued to rise and reach levels as high as 2.5 times above baseline. The increase in dopamine from cold water exposure of this kind was comparable to what one sees from it, except in this case, it wasn't a rise and crash. It was actually a sustained rise in dopamine that took a very long time, up to 3 hours, to come back down to baseline, which is really remarkable. And I think this explains some of the positive mental and physical effects that people report subjectively after doing cold water exposure. There are basically two different approaches to remaining in the cold when it's uncomfortable. One is to try and relax yourself, to try and practice slow breathing, to try and dilate your gaze. I've talked about this before in previous podcasts, to go into panoramic vision, to essentially try and calm yourself so that it's not as stressful in the cold. Other people, however, take the approach of trying to ramp up their level of internal autonomic arousal, meaning to get really energized and kind of lean into the friction of the cold, and they find that easier. Other people distract themselves. They recite the alphabet or they do something, anything to try and distract themselves from the discomfort. To be totally honest, it does not matter for sake of dopamine release, because the dopamine release is triggered and then continues even after you get out of the cold water. Now, in this study, it was long exposure to cold water. It was an hour. that's a long period of time. And I do warn you against getting into cold water that's so cold that it will make your temperature drop and make you hypothermic for an hour. That actually could be dangerous for a lot of people. You might have a hard time reheating, and hypothermia is not a good thing. They had people monitoring subjects in these studies and paying attention to their core body temperature. They were able to reheat them afterwards. It's well established now that getting into cold water, whether or not it's a shower, an ice bath, circulating cold water, a stream, et cetera, that can evoke the norepinephrine release immediately and the long arc of that dopamine release. Why would that be good? Up until now, I've basically said getting increases in dopamine are detrimental to your baseline. Well, this does appear to raise the baseline of dopamine for substantial periods of time. And most people report feeling a heightened level of calm and focus after getting out of cold water. So cold water exposure turns out to be a very potent stimulus for shifting the entire milieu, the entire environment of our brain and body, and allowing many people to feel much, much better for a substantial period of time after getting out of the ice bath or cold water of any kind than they did before. Now, you might ask how often to do this. Some people do this every day. It can be very stimulating, so typically doing it early in the day, it's going to be better. I don't necessarily recommend doing it right before sleep, but some people do it in the afternoon, and some people will indeed do that 7 days a week. Other people, 3 days a week. Other people, every once in a while. What I can say is, once you become cold water adapted, once it no longer has the same impact of novelty and feeling a bit like a, I don't want to say a shock to your system because you don't want to go into cold water shock, but once it is comfortable for you, then it will no longer evoke this release. There really does seem to be something in the pathway from cold water exposure through the norepinephrine pathway and into the mesolimbic brainstem that causes this release in dopamine. But nonetheless, it's a basically zero cost. I mean, you need access to water of some sort, cold water, shower, et cetera, but basically zero cost way of triggering a long-lasting increase in dopamine without ingesting anything, no pharmacology whatsoever. Please, again, approach it with safety and caution in mind, but it is a very potent stimulus. Again, 250% rise in baseline, 2.5 times rise in baseline rivals that of cocaine, which is really remarkable. Something I get asked about a lot for people that are curious about using deliberate cold exposure, which is how cold should the water be? And I know it's very hard to give a straight prescription for that because I think it boils down to what you just said, which is it's really the difference between your current temperature and really the temperature at the surface of your skin and the temperature of the water. So if you're very warm, getting into cold feels good. If you're already cold, getting into more cold feels stressful. Is there any way that we can start to gauge what is the best way to approach a deliberate cold exposure protocol? I mean, should it feel uncomfortable? And that leads into the question of how do we balance the discomfort with the amount of time that we spend in? So for instance, if it's just a little bit uncomfortable, will spending more time in the cold get us the same benefit as getting into very uncomfortably cold water for a very short period of time?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And I definitely think that this could be future studies on this as well to really unravel what kind of protocols are the best way, or also for which outcomes, of course. So if the temperature is very cold and you feel that, and you also feel very cold, then you should stay in the water a little bit longer. So I think it's just, you should get uncomfortable cold. So as long as you get uncomfortable cold, it's cold enough and you get this, what we call the cold shock. So the cold shock is activation of your sympathetic nervous system and these activation of the catecholamines, which you just mentioned before.
Does the shock mean that I'm having trouble controlling my breathing? Is that a good gauge?
Yeah, you can say so, because that's kind of like how we define it. So you hyperventilate, so you have a faster breathing rate. So that increases also because you activate your gasping reflex if you are new to this. But if you are adapted, it kind of subsides with time, with adaptation. So what you can do is that you can train this cold exposure and you can kind of like get adapted to it. So you don't have this hyperventilating response every time you go out in the cold water. So this is like building up your resilience, building up your adaptation. It's going to make this shock like subside a bit. So it's always harder in the beginning, but you should do hard things, right? It's not something that we You shouldn't think about cold water immersion as something that is comfortable. It should be hard because that's the point of it, right? If you enjoy it, then yeah, then I'm thinking something is wrong. It's not right. You should not enjoy it.
Well, this is an important point that you're making because I think that many people shy away from deliberate cold exposure because it's uncomfortable in a way that, at least from my experience, is very different than the discomfort of exercise. Because with exercise, for instance, if running hard, you know, running fast and breathing hard is uncomfortable, you can slow down or walk. If, you know, lifting weights is uncomfortable, you can remove some weight or reduce the number of repetitions or stop. With deliberate cold exposure, I suppose you can be sort of halfway in, halfway out of the water or partially underneath the cold shower, but it's very hard to titrate and adjust the level. It's kind of all or none. And I've seen, I can tell this by anecdote. I've done some work with military special operations. I won't say which country. This was outside the US. And these are very tough individuals. They're used to going without sleep and doing hard, high consequence, high risk kind of work. And they were asked to do some cold water exposure training. And I was there that day. And it was remarkable. About a third of them just went straight in and just kind of grinded through it. You know, like they looked stoic anyway to me. There were a few whimpers, no cries. About a third talked a lot and got really, you could tell that they were agitated and anxious, but they made it through. And then about a third of them just simply would not get in past their knees or thighs. It seemed like they were just dreading the whole experience. Some actually didn't actually go in completely, which was really surprising to me. And you couldn't tell based on their physical appearance or anything else about them. They're all high performers as to who would have this response. So it seems like people vary tremendously in terms of their ability to embrace the discomfort of the cold. Is that, from your studies, is that your experience as well? Or are there these weird mutants who seem to just love going into the cold for the first time?
So some people just feel better in the cold and some people dread the cold even more. And you can say the more people are pushing the cold away, they might feel the cold pain even more. So they would definitely, people who are maybe the soldiers you just talked about, some of them might be already adapted to the cold. So if they are not scared of the cold, they go out and they embrace the cold in a better way. It could also be that some people have a more sensitive nervous system. And when you are a bit sensitive to the cold, you will, of course, try to get away from it, right? And you will also have the cold pain more, feel the cold pain more if you avoid it. So the more you avoid the cold, the more painful it will feel when you go into it. So, yeah.